Yeah. So average is about 7.5, 8. And I'll try and keep it that way, right? So it's good that we're all happy and surrounded by happy people. What happens in agile teams is teams don't just become happy magically like this after having lunch. Right? A lot of effort goes into making them that way. Right. So here are five motivator tools. There's a shadow at the back. Oh, there's a guy. There are five motivator tools that leaders normally use. And these are one of the five of the most popular ones. Right. So what I'd like you to do is have a look at these five motivator tools and have a think about the environments, the teams that you come from. I wonder why. There's a guy who is walking behind him. It's now disconnected. Yeah, thanks. Yeah. So what I'll get you to do is think about the factors that you think is the number one. They're all important, pretty important, right? They're all equally good, but there's one that I want to call out that's above the rest of the five, right? So what I'll do is, again, get you to stand up because it's after lunch, so it's an agile session. You'll lose some weight. It's good. So if you were to rank one of these as the number one, highest of all, which one would you rank? So if you think providing clear goals is the number one motivator, you may sit down now. If you think providing interpersonal support is the number one motivator, you may sit down now. Interesting. If you think providing rewards and incentives is the number one motivator, you may sit down now. Providing support for making progress, if you think that's the number one motivator, you may sit down now. Wow. And then providing recognition for good work, if you think that's the number one motivator, you may sit down now. There's still some people standing. There were only five. Interpersonal support? Oh, that was the first one. Okay, and you've got something that's not here? All are required, but one above the other ones. All are equally important. Yep. So, and it's, let me get back to you. Oh, you've got another one. Yes. Okay, so it depends on the teams and the individuals in the teams. Good point, right? But generally, I'll get back to these motivators soon. Let me show you this first. It's of the goodies that they get back from China, right? And every time I go to China, after a few visits, I started running out of options as to what to bring back this time, right? And after a while, the Hello Kitty bags and the novelty chopsticks are not so novel anymore, right? So last time when I was going, I thought, I'll do something smart. I'll ask them before I go, what do they really want? After all, they're the product owners, right? So I asked my five-year-old son first, what do you want back from China this time? And he gave me three words, clear and explicit, just three words, remote control helicopter. So that's good. That's going to be easily sorted in no time. I'll get that fixed. Right? Then I asked my daughter, who's a couple of years older, said, Ember, what do you want from China this time? And she goes, oh, you know, Papa, something that's fun. And I said, what do you mean? Oh, you know, when you look at it, when it looks like fun, you just buy it for me. And I'm thinking, why do girls have to be so complex? Right. So I go to China, and then after a week's work, I start panicking because I've only got a day left, hit the markets, and I remember the acceptance criteria that they've given me. Remote control helicopter, sorted in 5 minutes. First shop, get it, buy, done, check. And then I'm thinking about my daughter's acceptance criteria. When you look at it, it looks like fun, you buy it. And I'm thinking, I'm going to be in trouble when I go back home. And then I suddenly remembered that she's in love with these guys. Right? And then, just by sheer fluke, I spotted this toy here, which is a miniature model of one of the minions. I thought, this looks like fun. I'm sure Amber's going to like it. So after a bit of haggling and negotiating, I buy this toy, and I bring it back home, give it to Amber, and she's full of excitement. opens it up immediately, lays it all on the floor and starts playing with it. And I'm thinking, what a wonderful dad I am. I know exactly what my daughter wanted, right? And then in a couple of minutes, there's a small problem. She's lost all interest, she's frustrated and walks away from the toy. And I'm getting a bit concerned. I say, Amber, what happened? Oh, no, this is too hard, I can't do this. So why? Oh, no, it's not, I can't do this. And this is the reason. This is the actual toy that I got from China, and it's got 200 pieces in it, right? And you can imagine for a little kid, each of the pieces are so tiny, you can't pick it up, let alone fit two pieces together, and it's got 200 pieces, and I'm now a little bit concerned, and I said, Amber, come back. I said, look at the photo here. What's your favorite part of the minion? And she reluctantly comes back and says, oh, guess what? The eyes, right? So it's a minion's eye. I said, let's do one thing. Of the 200 pieces, there are only 15 pieces that are gray. Let's sieve out all the gray pieces, and we'll just focus on the eye bit. And let's get the eye done. I'm sure you can do that. And I helped her find all the gray pieces, and then she put the eye together in about 5 minutes, right? And then now she's filled with excitement again, runs to mommy, mom, look, I've got the eye done. I got the minion's eye done. I said, Amber, come back. Look at the arms. They're long and small. I'm sure you can do that in no time, too. And then she starts finding the yellow bits that are straight and round and gets the arms done. And piece by piece, she eventually gets the whole minion built. Right. And it was just sheer achievements, the small wins that she was celebrating every so often. Realizing her own achievements regularly motivated to keep her or to complete the task. Right. Now imagine if I had used one of the other motivator techniques of just standing behind her, Amber, you can do it. Amber, you can do it. Somehow I don't think that would have worked. Right. And then in a more recent article, just following on from the theory, The Power of Small Wins, which was published by Amabel and Kramer in 2011, they also said that of all things that can boost emotion and motivation, the single most important is making progress in meaningful work. Right. So the progress principle has clear implications where our efforts should lie. Right. Now, what I want to do today in this session is share with you 5 secret tips. They are very simple tips, and this is the first one of the tips. The power of small wins. The 5 tips that I want to share with you are gonna help you create or mold a culture in which agile teams will thrive. And these 5 tips are not things or theories that have been published by everybody in one package. The baton? Yeah. Have you ever seen, even on telly, have you ever seen the camera being focused on the guy who's waiting on the 100-meter mark for the baton? What's he doing? Or guy or girl with the baton? Now, let's have this race here. Now, track 1, Japan. Track 2, Canada. Track 3, Jamaica. Track 4, USA. Track 5 will make it India, because all of a sudden, India's got good at running. Track 6 is even more amazing, ABC Consulting. ABC Consulting, because they claim that they can have 4 runners on the track who can run 100 meters sub 10 seconds. Right. So this is how ABC Consulting is going to conduct this race. As the race is about to start, they'll introduce a track manager on the track. And the track manager is going to come around to say, are you the guy with this girl with this block, the baton? This is the start line. All good. I'm happy with you. 100 meters down the track, you here. It's going to be 10 seconds by the time the baton gets to you. You know what? There's a high jump happening just here, beside here. in 10 seconds, can you do the high jump quickly, come back in time to continue on the race to give the baton to the 200-meter guy? 200-meter guy there? 20 seconds at least by the time the baton gets to you. A long jump's happening just behind you there. Can you do that long jump and be back in time to take the baton to the 300-meter guy there who will finish the race for us? But 300-meter guy, you know what? It's going to be ages by the time the baton gets to you. Track two, there's a 100-meter race happening. And you'll do that in 10 seconds. You'll be back in no time to finish the race for us. And that way, we are all fully utilized. And the race starts. You go to this, the baton gets to the 100-meter guy. He's still huffing and puffing back from the high jump that he's just done. He runs to the 200-meter guy who's just finishing off the long jump, coming back, has no context of this race, starts running that way. And he says, oh, no, 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 the other way, the other way. So he runs, he does a U-turn, goes the other way to the 300-meter guy who's nowhere to be seen because his 100-meter race on track two is still to be started. And in the meantime, all the other races are completing the race. And what's happening here is we are focusing on keeping the runners running rather than keeping the baton moving. And it's not just consulting organizations. A lot of organizations I see are operating this way, where things are being measured on how fast as our runners running, rather than delivering value. Right. Now, there are three aspects of any good agile environment: transparency, inspection, and adaption. And we all know that. Yet, when I go to a team and ask them as a coach, okay, so you are the same guys that were working on a waterfall, traditional waterfall project last month. This month, now you've suddenly started doing agile. What's different? How do you think differently? How do you operate differently? What's the answer? Stand up. Yeah, that's a classic one. Yeah. Or we do faster, we sprint faster. Or we do shorter sprints. Are those the answers you're looking for? No. So what's one thing that agile teams do differently? What's the fundamental difference? Yeah. Yeah, that's smaller sprints, right? Yeah. I'm looking for something different, and I'll tell you. Yeah. Inspecting and adapting, that's right. And that's what I was looking for. One thing that agile teams do differently or think differently about is how can we get better? There is nothing more important for agile teams to constantly think about is how can we get better at delivering value for our customers? How can we improve? And then those teams say, oh, yeah, we have PIRs, post-implementation reviews, also known as a postmortem. Postmortem, the person's already died. The project's finished. It's too late for this project. And then I get told, oh, no, it's for the next project. I haven't seen many projects where the learnings have been applied from a previous project, have you? Yet to see one. And then we all know that we should do retrospectives, like we need to go to the doctors and have checkups while we're still alive. It's more helpful. Right. And yet I get leaders and managers who are pushing back and not allowing their teams to do retrospectives because it's not seen as productive time. We are not writing code. A team of 20 people for one, this project hasn't even started. Imagine what effect such an article would have on the employees that are reading this article, especially the ones that will be working on this project. They all now know what's keeping the CIO awake. They all now share his vision and his dreams. Talking about dreams, This is my favorite quote by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and that's the only reason I've got this slide here. But I want to talk about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. In 1963, I guess, he gave I Have a Dream speech, right? And there were a quarter of a million people who turned up to listen to him. And Simon Sinek talks about this story where he talks about leaders and why people turned up to listen to him. So why did all of them turn up? Because they all believed in his dreams as well. And Simon talks about they are leaders and they are those who lead. Leaders are those that have an authority, a power, or an institutional authority. And those who lead are people who inspire us. And in this case here, everyone was inspired to go and listen to Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. because they shared his dreams. Right? And they wanted to go not because of him, because of them. Right? And also, they were not there because of what he was doing, but why he was doing it. Right? Now, they were all sharing his dreams. And I can't do justice to the way that this story is told. If you haven't watched this TED Talk by Simon Sinek, it's one of the highly most rated TED Talk ever. Start with why. Have a look at it. Right. Now, talking about dreams, when was the last time that you shared your dreams with somebody else? Especially with somebody at work. Sharing with them all your career aspirations. What do you want to achieve in your career? Have you ever shared what do you want to achieve in personal lives with someone at work, a team member? How many of you? Two out of all of you, right? Now, three, right? Sharing dreams can be quite risky because it makes us more vulnerable. Sharing dreams takes a lot of courage. And we find that it's easier to share our dreams with our loved ones, our close family and friends. Why? Why not with our teammates? Why only three people in the room have only shared dreams with our teammates? Why? Trust. Because we trust them. They don't judge you. They don't ridicule you. And that's the first step to achieving your dreams. If you are able to share your dreams with people surrounded with, they will help you achieve your dreams. And if you can't trust people to share your dreams with, how are you going to achieve anything with if you're surrounded by people you don't trust? Now, here's the thing. If there's only one message you want to take out of this session here today, make it this one. As leaders and managers, create an environment where it is safe for our team members to share their dreams with everybody else. Have a ritual, sharing of the dreams ritual, that's a frequent event in your teams. And then notice the difference. Because for that to happen, you will have to build trust in the teams. And then you see how efforts of all the team members magically align and become in sync. Takes a lot of effort. But try it. Now, talking about dreams, it's not just the team members who want to share. Most importantly, the leaders need to share their dreams. And we all know that leaders have to do two things, doing the work right and doing the right work. And we all know that it's the leaders that have to share their vision, their strategies, their dreams to cascade it down to the lowest of the levels for teams to achieve those dreams. It shouldn't be that difficult. I'll tell you, my top three weaknesses are, I'm number three, stubborn. I told you that already. Number six, shy. And 13, indecisive. That's what my wife tells me anyway. Right. You got your three biggest weaknesses? Yay, ready to move on? Okay, don't get too depressed. The next bit's much better, right? Now, look at the traits on the right-hand side of your three biggest weaknesses. Because I'm stubborn, I'm dedicated. Because I'm shy, I'm reflective. Because I'm indecisive, I'm patient. Right? Hidden in each of my weakness is a hidden strength. And the message here is simple. Instead of focusing on fixing my weaknesses or your weaknesses, embrace your hidden strengths. So how do you use this in teams? This is what I do. When we get a new agile team, when we're setting up a new agile team together, get them to do this openly so that everyone shares their weaknesses and strengths with each other. Because an agile team is only as effective if everyone in the team knows who to go to for a certain weakness and where to help with for a certain strength. If they don't know that within the team, they're going to struggle. So you've got to make sure that everyone knows each other's strengths and weaknesses. And for that to happen, you will have to have a team where the values have a huge overlap. For example, for this exercise to work, each team member will have to be transparent, will have to trust each other, and have respect for each other. Right? And nothing's, it's all normal, common agile values. So, and when it comes to the strengths, you've got to make sure that as leaders, building a team of people with a wide, broader horizon of strengths within the team. Don't get everyone with the same strengths in one team. Now, let me ask you another question. In your organization, when there is someone who's just been successfully, or been successful in completing an experiment, are they rewarded? You don't have to answer that. I just want you to think about this. And what about when that experiment fails? Are they still rewarded? Or are they punished? Now, just think about this. Are they still as willing to participate in another experiment after a failure? Are they encouraged to participate in another experiment after a failure? And this is what I want to talk about. This is the next bit is all about the thing we do, the interactive clapping game that we've done twice already today, right? Now, how many people have had those kind of surveys asked by your organization saying, we want to just see how engaged you are, how happy you are at work today? How many people have had those kind of surveys? Most of us, right? It's good. How many people have had those surveys where it at the bottom says, this is an anonymous survey. You can say whatever you like, it's safe. Most of you, right? Very good. Now, this is the thing. Why is it anonymous? This is my theory. It is anonymous because it's not safe to openly speak out in that organization. It underscores the fear of speaking up. It underscores the risk of speaking up. That's why it's anonymous. Right. It says a lot about your culture. I'll take it at the end if you have time. Right? And this is where I'll start to cause disruption and make a lot of people uneasy about, oh, it's anonymous because people won't speak up anyway. So create a culture where you can. Easy. No, it's not. It takes a lot of effort where you can have anonymous surveys abolished and have open surveys where people feel can safely say what they want to say. That's when you have achieved the optimal culture that's conducive to the agile way of working. Sorry? So it gets more personal with my questions now. We'll get to know each other quite well by the end of the session. Think about your KPIs. How are you measured? Are you measured on delivering value rather than just projects? Just don't think about just your own ones. Think about your manager's ones or your peers and your reports. How are they measured? Are they measured on delivering value rather than just projects? Now, here's the thing. a lot of organizations have embraced Agile and say we're doing Agile performance reviews and things like that. But the underpinning way that the success is measured for employees is still on the old style, old metrics. And what I'm seeing is a behavior which I've coined together as PDD, which is becoming more and more challenging in our environments today. And we need to make sure that we are not seeing agile leadership as just providing approvals, but providing true support to make progress, to provide true support to empower people, not just on paper say, oh yeah, you've got the rights to do everything. Right? Now, I want to tell you one last story before I wrap up. Have you got time for another story?
Yes.
Yeah? You're keen to hear another story?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. So what I've got here is, again, this was in Melbourne last year, this is more recent, where I was invited to help out a project team that was struggling because they had a fixed scope, fixed time delivery. Right? Sounds normal, right? Yeah. And they said, oh, we'll do Agile. And we'll get an Agile coach, and guess who the lucky one was. Right? So I went there, spent 2 weeks with the team, and I noticed that there was no sign of leadership or any people from the leadership team ever in the team area. I had never ever seen the exec managers or the delivery managers or anybody like that in the delivery areas. So in my next catch up with the EGM of the domain, I said, you know what? It would be really good if you could one day show up in our stand-ups or after the stand-ups to just give a brief on why we're doing this project and motivate people so that they know that they're doing it for somebody. And he goes, oh, yeah, yeah, next Tuesday I'm in the building, I'll come around. And I'm all excited, happy, good. So I prep the team, oh, the EGM's going to show up today, make sure you're all well-behaved, all blah, blah, blah. So, and then we have this Tuesday morning stand-up, and then after the stand-up, the EGM's called in, he comes in. What he said in that motivational talk. The November date is fixed. There's no room for negotiation with the date. The scope is fixed and socialized with the business. I empower you all to do whatever is necessary to deliver the agreed scope by this date. You are empowered to make all decisions with regards to how you want to implement the new product. If for any reason you are not able to deliver your piece, or if I find that you are delaying your pieces by waiting for answers, I will crucify you. These were the exact words of the EGM, empowering the team. Right? I'm standing beside him in that team where I've brought this guy to motivate the team, and now everyone's like scared, right? Because someone's going to get hurt real bad soon. And I was scared for myself as well. So notice how some words that we use just drag the energy down. And there are some words just project energy upwards and outwards. Right? And as leaders, we've got a choice of words. Right? We want to use the words wisely so that we project that energy outwards. But I hear words like headcount, execute, and terminate, all being used in the same sentence. And it seems like it's a scene from the Terminator movie where Arnold's going to be back and someone's going to get hurt real bad. So we, as leaders, we need to use the words wisely so that we project out that good energy, because our world needs our good energy. Our organizations need our good energy. The individuals and teams around us need that good energy. Let's use our words to project out that good energy. So that's the last one. The number five I have is use the power of words to project out that good energy to motivate teams and create a culture, an environment that suit those words, and vice versa. Right. And as leaders, we need to be careful And a way of, in wrapping up, I'd say we'd have to be careful of all the things, the five things that we're using, all to do with our actions, our attitudes, our behaviors, and also our words. Right. The first one, to use the power of small wins to create that motivation. Right. Second one, amplify good behavior to create that good, good culture. The last one, the third one is use the power of dreams to align everyone to the same thinking. Right. Measure what matters so that you can get where you want to be with that culture, because you only get what you measure. And the last one, use the power of words to project out that good energy. Right. And finally, in wrapping up, I'd like to urge you to use the simple ingredients to mold and shape, not create. We can't create culture, but we can mold and shape that culture in which agile teams will thrive. Right. And I can assure you that you will start reaping the full benefits of your agile teams then. Thanking you. Any questions? We got one at the back. Just, do you need a mic or can shout?
What about actually, I think all these mics are ingredients are very good, but the basic thing is that everybody should love their jobs. That's what I think.
Should love their jobs. How do you make people love their jobs, though? If you think that people should be loving, what's that? Passionate about it, right? And this is what I'm saying here, is to create that passion, is all of these things will help that passion being cascaded up and down and sideways, right? It's only when people share the same passion, the same dreams, the same vision, that's when the teams become successful as a unit, right? If you're not sharing that passion with the other team members, because the team's only as good as the individuals within the teams and vice versa, right? So if you're not sharing the same passion, the team's not going to function as a unit, right? It's same as a sporting field, a sporting team, right? So your goal should be one, to win as the team, not to shine as an individual. Good question. Yeah? One more? Yeah?
You've taken classical examples like that applies to 90% of the organizations, right? Yes. There are 10% organizations who implement things good. They learn, they try to implement.
Yes.
They still fail. So
yes.
With your experience, do you see this as a perfect model?
Well, good question. Yes.
It can be. There's something coming up.
Yeah. So one of the things, I think it's a good question. You're highlighting that there are 90% of the organizations that fall into the pitfall, and there are 10% that are doing it really well, right? And the idea here is to learn from those 10% and see what they are doing really well to employ that in the other 90%, right? Because life's too short to make all our mistakes ourselves, right? But I don't have, there are people who are coming in and out. Yeah, we'll need to wrap up now. So thank you all. Thanks for the...